لا إله إلا الله لا إله إلا الله لا إله إلا الله ما لنا رب سوى.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستبينه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، إنه من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأصلي وأسلم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Today inshallah we're going to resume our reflections on Surah Yusuf, and we're going to start with Allah saying فلما سمعت بمكرهن أرسلت إليهن وأعتدت لهن متكأ وآتت كل واحدة منهن سكينا وقالت اخرج عليهن فلما رأينه أكبرنه وقطعن أيديهن وقلن حاش لله ما هذا بشرا إن هذا إلا ملك كريم. When she heard of their malicious talk, she sent for them and prepared for them a sumptuous repast and handed each one of them a knife and said to Yusuf, come out and present yourself to them. When they saw him, they were amazed at him and they cut their hands, exclaiming, God preserve us, this is no mortal man, this is none other than a noble angel. So, when the prime minister's wife, she heard the talk of the women in the city, that they have started to talk about her, they have made her a subject of their conversations, private conversations and talk. They talked about the incident that took place between her and between her slave lad, Prophet Yusuf, and they blamed her for what she did. When she heard that, she prepared a banquet for them. She arranged for them a banquet, and she invited them all. And if we have a banquet, if we have a banquet that is prepared or arranged by the prime minister's wife, you can imagine the social status of the women who are invited to attend such a banquet. For sure, they were not from among the common people, right? So they must have belonged to the aristocratic class in the city or in the whole kingdom. So she invited them, she prepared the banquet for them, and she prepared sofas, couches for them, and she gave each and every one of them a knife, and they started to, you know, to eat, either to cut the meat with the knife or to peel the fruits with the knife. And the Quran says, وَأَعْتَدَتْ لَهُنَّ مُتَّكَأَ. She prepared for them cushions or sofas or couches. This gives us an indication on how luxurious those people were to sit, you know, reclining on your side on sofas, and you're eating while you are reclining in such a manner. This tells us how luxurious those people were. And also, the knives. Do you imagine that people thousands of years ago, thousands of years ago, and they used knives in eating or peeling the fruits? This tells us about the material civilization or the level of the material civilization those people attained or obtained back then or at that time. So, when they saw Prophet Yusuf, they were amazed at him. They were very, very amazed because, as you all know, Prophet Yusuf was given a half of beauty. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed by Prophet Yusuf on the night of Isra in the third heaven, and he said, فَإِذَا بِهِ, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said or commented, فَإِذَا بِهِ قَدْ أُعْطِيَ شَطْرَ الْحُسْنِ. He was given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a half of beauty. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So they cut their hands and they said, God preserve us. God preserve us. This is no mortal man. This is none other than a noble angel. Their saying, this statement, is also an indication that there were some traces of the divine faith in that community. Those people, they knew something about monotheism. They knew something about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, though their conduct didn't reflect that. But they had that knowledge in them, and it was only some traces. Because if you remember, we said before that, those people, the ruling elite of Egypt back then or at that time, were from nomadic tribes. They came from the Arabian Peninsula. So they had some contact with the previous prophets, like Prophet Ibrahim and Prophet Ismail and Prophet Ishaq. That's why they have some sort of, not knowledge, but they have some traces in their faith that belong to that faith or to monotheism. Now, she won the battle. The prime minister's wife, she won the battle. She heard about their conversation about her, right? And she brought them in order for them to see Prophet Yusuf with their naked eyes. And when they saw him, they were amazed at him. Now, she's telling herself, I have all the right of what I have done. Because even you, though you have spoken about me, you couldn't resist his charm. Even you were amazed at him. So now she feels like she has scored her point and gained victory over them all. Will this stop her? No, she won't be stopped. She was resistant. She was insistent of, you know, in doing or in fulfilling what she was after. قالت فذلكن الذي لمتنني فيه. This is he on whose account you have blaming me. And as you can see how handsome he is and how manly he is. He's very, very handsome and he's very, very manly. So how can I resist him? قالت فذلكن الذي لمتنني فيه. وَلَقَدْ رَاوَدْتُهُ عَنْ نَفْسِهِ فَاسْتَعْصَمَ. Now she admits her crime. She makes it public. She is convulging that secret in front of all those women because she was shameless. And this is one of the qualities of those people who lead a very luxurious life, they lose their chastity. And they lose their honor, and they go after their lusts, and only lust drives them and drives their whole life. وَلَقَدْ رَاوَدْتُهُ عَنْ نَفْسِهِ فَاسْتَعْصَمْ. Indeed, I have tried to seduce him, but he safeguarded his chastity. He refused to comply with what I have ordered him to do. وَلَقَدْ رَاوَدْتُهُ عَنْ نَفْسِهِ فَاسْتَعْصَمَا. وَلَئِنْ لَمْ يَفْعَلْ. Now, however, if he doesn't do what I bid him, if he doesn't do what I ordered him to do, وَلَئِنْ لَمْ يَفْعَلْ مَا آمُرُهُ لَيُسْجَنَنَّ. He will certainly be imprisoned. I will put him in prison. لَيُسْجَنَنَّ وَلَيَكُونَ مِّنَ الصَّاغِرِينَ. And shall indeed be humiliated. He will receive humiliation. He will receive two things, imprisonment and humiliation as well. So now we can see that weird mixture of temptation, resistant and threat and warning as well. She is threatening him and she is warning him. Either you do as you are told or you're going to be humiliated and sent to prison. But what was Prophet Yusuf's reply or his reaction? The Quran doesn't leave us, you know, amazed or anticipating what Prophet Yusuf said or what his reaction was. The Quran immediately tells us about his reaction. قال رب السجن أحب إلي مما يدعونني إليه. So, Prophet Yusuf simply turns to his Lord with an appeal. He starts to invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He starts to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and supplicate for him to help him pass this affliction, because this was a severe and a tremendous affliction indeed. قال رب السجن أحب إلي مما يدعونني إليه. My Lord, I would sooner be put in prison than comply with what they are inviting me to do. Prophet Yusuf here is invoking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and at the same time he is showing that he started to love prison. Do you imagine that there is any person on this whole planet loves to be imprisoned? Can you imagine that? Prophet Yusuf said, قَالَ رَبِّ السِّجْنُ أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ. It wasn't only that Prophet Yusuf accepted his fate to be sent to prison, but he also said that, no, being imprisoned is much, it's much dearer to me than complying with what they were inviting me to. So, a sijn or prison, it turns to be something precious and something loved to Prophet Yusuf. You know why? Because it would protect him. It would protect him from what they were calling him to. And what were they calling him or inviting him to do? They were calling him or inviting him to false glory. Do you imagine that a slave, he was a slave, and he was ordered or asked by his mistress, the prime minister's wife, to do something with her. Were he to comply with that and were he to be obedient to her, he would be associated with the wife of the second strongest man in the whole kingdom. And you can imagine the form of authority that he would has, right? But he refused all this, and he knew for sure that this is not glory, this is not authority, but this is a false glory. A false glory that is wished for only by those whose hearts are afflicted with disease. And as a prophet, he wasn't one of those people. SubhanAllah. So, prison turns into a dear request by Prophet Yusuf because, and he wished for being put in prison in order to be saved and protected from their invitation or from what they were calling him to do. Another thing, Prophet Yusuf says, قَالَ رَبِّ السِّجْنُ أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّا تدعونني إليه مما ها يدعونني إليه. So he said what they are inviting me to do, and he didn't say what she is inviting me to do. Why did Prophet Yusuf say مما يدعونني إليه, what they are inviting me to do, and not what she is inviting me to do? Why? Anyone? So there was a common interest, right? Even among them. Perfect. Jazakumullah khairan. So they were all part of the seduction temptation. They all participated in that. And the scholars say that they revealed their beauty to him in order to seduce him and in order to tempt him as well. And there is another thing. Some scholars said that before Prophet Yusuf was ordered to enter upon them and to reveal his beauty in front of them, or to, you know, to present himself in front of them, they all have agreed to fake a suicide attempt. And that's why the lives were given to them, to fake a suicide attempt. To fake that, if you don't apply, if you don't agree, if you don't agree, if you don't comply, we're gonna cut our arches, you know, we're gonna kill ourselves. And that's why the Quran says, وَقَطَعْنَا, not وَقَطَعْنَا. وَقَطَعَ means to hurt someone, to cut, you know, to cut yourself. But وَقَطَعْنَا means you did that repeatedly and intentionally. So وَقَطَعْنَا أَيْدِيَهُنَّ. So some scholars say that that's why he included them in his plea, in his word. What they are inviting me to do, and not only what she is inviting me to do. Here Prophet Yusuf, when he supplicates for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he makes dua for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is using the power of the weapon of supplication, the weapon of dua, the weapon of dua. الدعاء مخ العبادة. And الدعاء هو العبادة. In the narration by Tirmidhi, الدعاء هو العبادة. Supplication or دعاء is worship, is an act of worship in itself. So he has used this because he knew that he was in a hardship. He was in a great affliction, in a great trial or tribulation. And no one can save him but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whenever you are afflicted with anything, whenever you find yourself in hot waters, in a very bad situation, you should seek Allah's help and Allah's assistance, because it's only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who can deliver you out of this situation and who can save you from this situation. وَإِلَّا تَصْرِفْ عَنِّي كَيْدَهُنَّ. Unless you turn away their guile from me. So, the only one who can turn away the guile from Prophet Yusuf or from any afflicted person is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, you should seek his help and seek his assistance whenever you are afflicted with anything. وَإِلَّا تَصْرِفْ عَنِّي كَيْدَهُنَّ أَصْبُ إِلَيْهِنَّ. I may yield to them. I may comply to them. I may yield to them and وَأَكُمْ مِنَ الْجَاهِرِينَ and lapse into folly, or become one of the ignorant. But here, why one of the ignorant? Why one of the ignorant? Scholars say that an ignorant person is the sinful person and is the one who commits sins. Though he might be one of the most knowledgeable of all people. If you have someone who's a great scholar, he's a university professor, for example, but he, and no one can say that he is ignorant, right? If one has a PhD or something, or multiple PhDs, and no one can label him and say that he is ignorant. But in Islam's sight, in Islam's eyes, it's not that knowledge that you acquire, it's the conduct that you produce. So if the knowledge doesn't increase you in terms of faith and modesty and draws you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so it will be useless. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in a hadith, man izdada ilman wa lam yazdad hudan لَمْ يَزْدَدْ مِنَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا بُعْدًا وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. Whoever is increased in knowledge and this knowledge doesn't draw him closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَمْ يَزْدَدْ مِنَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا بُعْدًا, this knowledge will take him away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مَنْ ازْدَادَ عِلْمًا وَلَمْ يَزْدَدْ هُدًى لم يزدد من الله إلا بعدا. He becomes very distant from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to be very distant from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so you are nothing. You are nothing. Because no one can be anything. No one can be anything without being attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and being associated with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You attach yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? And I believe we can put this in a very, very short expression. No God, no value. When there is no God, when there is no Lord, when there is no Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so there is no value to anything. Anything becomes without any value. وَإِلَّا تَصْرِفْ عَنِّي كَيْدَهُنَّ أَصْبُ إِلَيْهِنَّ وَأَكُمْ مِنَ الْجَاهِلِينَ. So here, Prophet Yusuf, he is showing the human weakness that is there in each and every one of us. And without Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we cannot make up for this weakness, or no one can rescue us from this weakness. So the best way for anyone to gain Allah's care and His protection is to invoke Him subhanahu wa ta'ala to help you and to assist you in such situations. Did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala leave him alone? No. فَاسْتَجَابَ لَهُ رَبُّهُ. فَاسْتَجَابَ. And in Arabic, we have two particles that are used in, you know, such situations or similar situations. We have fa and we have thumma. Fa and the thumma. So what is the difference between fa and the thumma? Thumma means that this thing happened and then after a while the other thing happened. But fa means that one thing happens and immediately, spontaneously, on the spot, the other thing happens. And this is the one that is used here. فَاسْتَجَابَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't leave him alone in this predicament. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent relief and rescue to him on the spot. فَاسْتَجَابَ لَهُ رَبُّهُ فَصَرَفَ عَنْهُ كَيْدَهُنَّ إِنَّهُ هُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. His Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, answered his prayer immediately on the spot and warded off their guile from him. فَصَرَفَ عَنْهُ كَيْدَهُنَّ. He turned away, warded off their guile from him. It is he alone who hears all and knows all. إِنَّهُ هُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. But how did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala صَرَفَ عَنْهُ كَيْدَهُنَّ? How did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ward off their guile from him? Either Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them despair of his yielding to them. So he will never, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them know for sure that and become certain that Prophet Yusuf will never submit to their will. Well, he will never do whatever they are asking him or inviting him to do. And the other thing is that maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put more strength in his heart. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put more strength in his heart in order to defy them and in order to challenge them and not to comply with what they were inviting him to do. فَاسْتَجَابَ لَهُ رَبُّهُ. So wallahi, whenever anyone is afflicted with anything and he sincerely directs his face to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and invokes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and asks him for help, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never leave him alone. This is for sure. But you have to do this with full and complete sincerity and trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't test Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't test Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't you ever dare to test Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you do it sincerely from your heart, from the depth of your heart, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will rescue and will be there for you, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ever watching over every one of us and He is there subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَاسْتَجَابَ لَهُ رَبُّهُ فصرف عنه كيدهن إنه هو السميع العليم. It is He alone who hears all and knows all. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears their scheming. إنه هو السميع. Allah hears their scheming and hears the prayers and the invocation and the dua of Prophet Yusuf. العليم. He knows the intention behind the scheming and he knows the purpose of the dua or the supplication of Prophet Yusuf. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always there. He's never absent from anything or from any situation, subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّهُ هُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. So here we can see that Prophet Yusuf was relieved or rescued, alhamdulillah, by Allah's grace and favor from this second trial, because that was his second trial. If you remember, his first trial was with his own brothers when they threw him into the depth of or the bottom of that well. But here, his second trial was to be tempted by the prime minister's wife and those women with her. And he succeeded. He became victorious and successful and triumphant by Allah's grace and favor. Alhamdulillah. Subhanallah. Prophet Yusuf sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he sought Allah's help, he showed us that he admits his human weakness. So again, whenever you are afflicted with anything, don't count on yourself. Count on your Creator. Don't count on your strength. Count on the strength and the might of your Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith that is recorded in the two sahihs, Al-Bukhari and Muslim, سَبْعَةٌ يُظِلُّهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي ظِلِّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ. Seven people, seven categories of people whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them shade on the day where there is no shade but His subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of them is وَرَجُلٌ دَعَتْهُمْ رَأَةٌ ذَاتُ مَنْصِبٍ وَجَمَالٍ فَخَالَ إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهَ. A man who refuses the call of a charming woman of noble birth for illicit intercourse with her, and he says, I am fearful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I am afraid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I cannot do this. We have to remember this. Now, Prophet Yusuf, alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala relieved him and rescued him from that temptation. But those people, we are talking about people who do not feel any shame. They do not feel any shame. The luxurious life they used to lead, it took away their shame from them and their honor from them. Then the Quran says, ثُمَّ بَدَى لَهُمْ بَدَى ثُمَّ بَدَى لَهُمْ ثُمَّ بَدَى لَهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا رَأَوْا الْآيَاتِ لَيَسْجُنُنَّهُ حَتَّى حِينَ. Then it occurred to them, it came to their minds, it popped up, you know. Then it occurred to them, after they had seen the proofs of his innocence, to imprison him for a time. SubhanAllah. So, this is another trial. This is another trial. This is the third trial. And don't worry, this is gonna be the last trial of hardship. Prophet Yusuf is gonna go through, inshallah. And this trial is the trial of imprisonment. He's gonna be sent to prison. His punishment for his chastity and for safeguarding his chastity is to be sent to prison. You know why? For those people to maintain their appearances, to maintain their reputation. And we're gonna come to this. But here, now, ثُمَّ بَدَى لَهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا رَأَوُ الْآيَاتِ. After they have seen all the proofs and the evidences that he was innocent, he was 100% innocent, they decided to send him to prison. And for For an innocent person to find himself in prison, this is very hard indeed, right? Though he may console himself by telling himself that I'm innocent. I haven't committed any crime. Though he can say that, but still it's gonna be very, very hard for him. Because a'zamallahu jami'an, imprisonment is not an easy thing. To be imprisoned, you know, in a closed room for years and years, and you don't have any control over yourself or control over your own will, you can do nothing, even to yourself. This is very, very hard indeed. And imagine that he was a prophet. He was sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide those people to the right path, and they do this to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, we have the people of the palace, we have the prime minister's wife, and the prime minister himself, and the aristocratic people. And after they saw that he was innocent, they decided that he should go to prison. And this is what is expected from those people. This is what is expected from such people, right? Because, as I said, they have no shame or honor. And the prime minister's wife, she didn't decide to send Prophet Yusuf to prison unless she was certain that he will never yield to her. And another thing, they must have known that the incident or the accident or the thing that happened, it was divulged and it went beyond the walls of the palace. And everyone started to talk about what happened in the first incident when she tried to tempt him in private, and then what happened between her and the women and Prophet Yusuf. So they decided to get rid of him by sending him to prison. If you remember, we said that her husband, the prime minister, he didn't take any action. He didn't take any action. And he left them together in the same palace. He didn't change that situation. So he wasn't a real man. But now, he becomes a real man and he imprisons an innocent person. So he couldn't stand in front of his wife and he told her very nice things. Inna kayda kunna azim. Your guile is awesome indeed. But now, he considers himself or sees himself as a powerful man, a man of authority, and he sends an innocent man into prison. You can imagine the mentality and the attitude. وَدَخَلَ مَعَهُ السِّجْنَ فَتَيَانِ. Now Prophet Yusuf is in prison. He is imprisoned. ودخل معه السجن فتيان قال أحدهما إني أراني أعصر خمرا وقال الآخر إني أراني أحمل فوق رأسي خبزا تأكل الطير منه نبئنا بتأويله إنا نراك من المحسنين. And there entered with him two young men in the prison. One of them said, verily, I saw myself in a dream pressing wine. The other said, verily, I saw myself in a dream carrying bread on my head, and birds were eating thereof. They said, inform us of the interpretation of this. Verily, we think you are one of the doers of good. Scholars say that those two men, one of them was the king's distiller, the one who used to press wine for the king, and the other was his baker, the one who used to make bread for the king. Okay, and they must have been accused of something in order to be sent to prison, as so many other people. But here, as you can see, the surah takes us from the scene, takes us immediately from the scene where Prophet Yusuf was with the prime minister's wife and the other women. And then we find him in prison with those two men who are addressing him and asking him to interpret their dreams for them. And they are saying that إِنَّكَ مِنَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ إِنَّا نَرَكَ مِنَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. So there must have been an interval. There must have been some time that passed while Prophet Yusuf was in prison. So he must have stayed for a while in prison in order for those people to get to know him and to realize that he was one of the doers of good, right? But the surah deletes or omits all this. The surah deletes all the details about his entering that prison and the way he treated the other prison mates and the way he treated the guards in the prison and the way the guards treated him and all these things, right? Or the things through which those men saw that and became confident and certain that Prophet Yusuf was a righteous person. The surah omits all these because these will not increase us in knowledge or faith. They said, إِنَّا نَرَاكَ مِنَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. But the word muhsin, it doesn't only mean that one is doing good or one is doing good deeds. But if we go to the Surah Al-Dhariyat, for example, we can find a complete and full map of that can explain the word muhsin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الْمُتَّقِينَ فِي جَنَّاتٍ وَعُيُونَ آخِذِينَ مَا آتَاهُمْ رَبُّهُمْ إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا قَبْلَ ذَلِكَ فِي الدُّنْيَا in this prison life, مُحْسِنِينَ. So what were the qualities? What were the things that made them مُحْسِنِينَ? كَانُوا قَلِيلًا مِّنَ اللَّيْلِ مَا يَهْجَعُونَ وَبِالْأَسْحَارِ هُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ وَفِي أَمْوَالِهِمْ حَقٌّ لِلسَّائِلِ وَالْمَحْرُومِ. So they had three qualities. One of them was that they used to sleep but little of the night. They used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the night. They used to recite the Quran, to stand for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in prayer and to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala most of the night and to sleep just for little time. وَبِالْأَسْحَارِهُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. And when the last part of the night comes or befalls them, they start to seek Allah's forgiveness. And the Imam al-Nasafi in his tafsir says, he says, وَبِالْأَسْحَارِهُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلْ وَكَأَنَّهُمْ قَضَوْا اللَّيْلَ كُلَّهُ يَعْصُونَهُمْ. Imam al-Nasafi in his tafsir says, when the last part of the night befalls them, they start to seek Allah's forgiveness as if they were or as if they have spent the whole night committing crimes or committing sins. Can you imagine? Can you imagine how many of us who do this? How many of us who do this? How many of us who supplicate Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and who stays most of the night awake, remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, reading the Quran and praying for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How many of us? If you do this, say Alhamdulillah and continue. If not, it's a time to start. It's a high time to start. I'm reminding myself before I'm reminding you or telling you that. I'm reminding myself of this. So now, Prophet Yusuf, he is in prison with those people, and they came to him to ask him to interpret their dreams for them. Prophet Yusuf, he doesn't waste this golden opportunity. It's a golden opportunity for him. It's a golden opportunity for any caller to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you are a preacher, when you are a da'iyah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you should be, because every one of us is a da'iyah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you don't have to stay until you accumulate knowledge. No, الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم said, بلغوا عني ولو آية. Convey and teach people and educate people, even if you are there, if you got only one ayah, if you got one piece of information. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants you and gives you only one piece of information, you have the responsibility to convey it to others. So Prophet Yusuf here, he doesn't waste the opportunity. He seizes the opportunity. These are people, they are in need of knowing something, and they are in a very bad condition. And there is no condition that is worse, or that is, you know, worse than being in the condition of disbelief. Those people were disbelievers. They didn't know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it was his responsibility to rescue them from that condition and from that situation. So he seizes the opportunity to speak to them about his faith. They came to ask him about the dream and to interpret the dreams for them. But he has something which is more significant than the dream. So he has seized, he seized that opportunity to talk to them and to speak to them about his faith, which is the true faith, which is the faith of Islam, which is monotheism, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only Lord, the only God, the only deity who deserves to be worshipped in this whole universe and beyond. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, being in prison for Prophet Yusuf, this doesn't exempt him from his duty of conveying Allah's da'wah to others. Whenever you are in any situation, at school, at work, on the bus, on a train, when you meet people, talk to them. Speak with them about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But you have to choose the way. You have to choose how to approach them. ادعو إلى سبيل ربك بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة. بالحكمة. بالحكمة. Be smart. When you do da'wah to people, be smart. قال لا يأتيكما طعام ترزقانه إلا نبأتكما بتأويله. قال لا يأتيكما طعام ترزقانه. He said, no food will come to you as your provision, but I will inform you of its interpretation. No food will come to you as your provision this day until I tell you about the type of food that's gonna be sent to you or that you're gonna be provided. This is, why did he say that? He is telling them that I'm gonna tell you about something which no one knows. Something which is part of the unseen. Because the prisoners, they don't know what type of food is gonna be provided for them, right? But he would tell them about that type of food. This is to make them certain that he is capable of interpreting their dreams for them. If he knows something of the unseen, so he must be capable of or has the skill to interpret the dreams for them. So he is assuring them that I am gonna solve your problem for you. I'm gonna interpret the dreams for you. And as an evidence, as a proof that I have that capability and the ability and the skill to do that, I am gonna tell you about the type of food that is gonna be brought to you today, before it comes to you. Okay? قَالَ لَا يَأْتِيكُمَا طَعَامٌ تُرْزَقَانِهِ إِلَّا نَبَّأْتُكُمَا بِتَأْوِيلِهِ قبل أن يأتيكما. Before it comes. ذلكما مما علمني ربي. And he didn't say that. Wallahi. Whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants you or gives you knowledge or a skill or a property or anything, don't say that this is out of my skill. I have gained this because of my knowledge, because I'm smart, because I'm You have been given all this by Allah's grace and Allah's favor, and you have to admit this. قال ذلكما مما علمني ربي. This is of what which my Lord has taught me. All this has been granted and given to me by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my Lord. And he started to talk to them or to speak to them about his Lord and the qualities, some of the qualities of his Lord. ذلكما مما علمني ربي إني تركت ملة قوم لا يؤمنون بالله وهم بالآخرة هم كافرون. Verily, I have abandoned the religion of a people that believe not in Allah and are disbelievers in the hereafter. So, now, he is referring to the people who raised him in the palace. The prime minister and his wife, they were polytheists. They used to worship idols. They were idol worshippers. And the people of the aristocracy, and the people of the society, and the two men who are asking him to interpret the dreams for them, they were from among those people who worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They used to ascribe partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But see how smart Prophet Yusuf was. He didn't say that directly to them. ادعو إلى سبيل ربك بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة وجادلهم بالتي هي أحسن. So he gave them a general statement. إني تركت ملة قوم. He didn't say, I have abandoned your religion in which you worship the idols, in order not to embarrass them. Again, ادعو إلى سبيل ربك بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة وجادلهم بالتي هي أحسن. And instead of approaching the subject in a very direct and blunt way, he put it, so here, ادعو إلى سبيل ربك بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة, as we said. Invite to the way of your Lord with wisdom and good instruction, and argue with them in a way that is best. And then he says, لا يؤمنون بالله واليوم الآخر. Why واليوم الآخر? Because if they do not believe in the last day, the day of judgment, so they do not believe in the reward or in the punishment. So anyone can do anything. Now, if you do not believe that there is going to be an accountability, that you're going to be held responsible for what you have done throughout your life in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala one day, so you can do whatever you want. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the just, wal-adl subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never leave us, will never leave the oppressor without punishing him, and will never leave the oppressed without restoring his right to him and restoring justice to him. And also, when he says disbelievers in the hereafter, this means that belief in the hereafter is part and parcel of belief, part and parcel of the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that all the prophets and the messengers that came before Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam advocated this as well. So they asked the people, they ordered the people, they invited the people to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to believe in the hereafter, and that they are going to be responsible and be held accountable for whatever they have done throughout their whole life. وَاتَّبَعْتُ مِلَّةَ آبَائِي إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ. And I have followed the religion of my fathers, Ibrahim, Ishaq, and Ya'qub. So he is telling them that I have avoided disbelief, I have avoided polytheism, and I have followed monotheism and tawheed that was brought with Prophet Ibrahim, Prophet Ishaq, and Prophet Ya'qub, my fathers. And here he is talking about his father Ya'qub, Prophet Ya'qub, and his grandfather and his grand-grandfather. ما كان لنا أن نشرك بالله من شيء. And never could we attribute any partners whatsoever to Allah. ذلك من فضل الله علينا وعلى الناس. This is from the grace of Allah to us and to mankind. So Tawheed, monotheism, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed us the way of Tawheed and monotheism, this is out of the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is of the grace, or out of the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ذلك من فضل الله علينا, as prophets, وعلى الناس, as he sent us, the prophets and the messengers, to guide the people and to teach them about monotheism and about Tawheed. ذلك من فضل الله علينا وعلى الناس ولكن أكثر الناس لا يشكرون. But most men thank not. And we're gonna conclude with this. We're gonna conclude this tonight, inshallah. Now, Prophet Yusuf is saying that ولكن أكثر الناس لا يشكرون. But most men thank not. Most men are not thankful or grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you follow the traces, or if you follow the locations in the Quran where the word most and where the word few are mentioned, you're gonna find something which is very, very interesting. So if we compare between the majority and the minority in the Quran, you're gonna find this very, very interesting. Just listen to these ayahs, not ayahs, but parts of the ayahs. Just listen. ولكن أكثر الناس لا يشكرون. But most men thank not. ولكن أكثر الناس لا يعلمون. But most men do not know. ولكن أكثر الناس لا يعقلون. But most men do not use reason. وأكثرهم للحق كارهون. But most of them to the truth are averse. They hate the truth. وما أكثر الناس ولو حرصت بمؤمنين. And most of the people, although you strive for it, are not believers. They will never believe. ألهاكم التكاثر حتى زرتم المقابر. التكاثر. So competition and worldly increase diverts you until you visit the graveyards. Compare all these references to the majority of people with the following ones. وقليل من عبادي الشكور. And few of my servants are grateful. إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وقليل ما هم. Except for those who believe and do righteous deeds, and few are they. وما آمن معه إلا قليل. But none had believed with him except a few. لأحتنكن ذريته إلا قليلا. Satan, I will surely destroy his descendants except for a few. So, after reading all this, after making this comparison, one may ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from among the few. Allahumma ja'alna min al-qaleel. Because the few are the dearest ones to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are the obedient to Allah, they are the believers to Allah, they are the believers in Allah, they are the faithful to Allah and the grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from among the few who believe in Him and who are grateful to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. جزاكم الله خيرا. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك, أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت, نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, والعصر, إن الإنسان لفي خسر, إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. جزاكم الله خيرا, والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.